Welcome everybody to our joint astronomical colloquium. My name is Stefan Braun and it's a great pleasure for me to introduce to you our today's speaker, Professor Richard Ellis. Professor Ellis got his PhD in 1974 and since September 2015 he is a professor at the University College in London and is now on a leave as a senior scientist at ESO in Garching. Before he was professor in Durham, Cambridge and Caltech. Additionally, he had many external appointments, is in several publication boards and scientific committees and has been awarded with several prestigious prizes like the Cosmology Prize, the Gold Medal of the Royal Astronomical Society, the Breakthrough Prize in Fundamental Physics, just to mention a few of them. Professor Ellis mainly works on observational cosmology. He deals with the origin of galaxies and the large-scale structures of the universe. He was also a member of the Supernova Cosmology Project, whose leader Sol Hermutashert the 2011 Nobel Prize in Physics for the discovery of the accelerating expansion of the universe. His most recent discoveries relate to searches for the earliest known galaxies, which are seen now at an age which is only a few percent of the present age of our universe. And today's talk is related to this issue. We are looking forward to your talk on spectroscopic studies of galaxies in the reionization era.
Thank you. Nice to be back in Heidelberg again. And I want to tell you a little bit about progress in studying the very earliest galaxies and their role in reionization. So this image that you see here is the deepest current image we have with the Hubble Space Telescope in the infrared. So it's an area of about 3 arc minutes across, taken with a wide field camera on the Hubble Space Telescope. And it represents an integration of something like about 10 days in total. So what you see is of course about several thousand galaxies, but the ones that I've highlighted here are the most distant objects that are seen in this image. And we're looking back, as was mentioned, to a time when the universe was only a few percent of its present age. So this is a very exciting developing subject, and what I want to convince you today is that we're making good progress in understanding how different galaxies developed, and particularly the role that they play in what we call cosmic reionization. So let me tell you what cosmic reionization is. So this is a cartoon, and obviously with time running along the from left to right here, this is the microwave background, so this is the thermal glow from the Big Bang, 370,000 years after the Big Bang. And at that time, the hydrogen atom forms for the first time. Now the dark matter has already fractionated out of the cosmic expansion and has begun to cluster itself. And we see that signature in the fluctuations in the microwave background itself. So when the hydrogen atom forms for the first time, it's drawn into the dark matter halos, and those hydrogen clouds become critical, they cool and collapse, and they form the very first stellar systems by nuclear burning. Now these stars are metal-free. The heavy elements are not produced in the Big Bang. And so these stars are much hotter than the present-day stars that have heavy elements in them. So these early stars and stellar systems emit large amounts of ultraviolet radiation. And this ultraviolet radiation photoionizes the region around the galaxies, creating these ionized bubbles, just like H2 regions in the Milky Way. And presumably, as time progresses, these ionized regions expand, and they become more numerous as more stellar systems collapse and form. And eventually these ionized bubbles overlap and the universe is completely ionized in deep space. And we've known the universe is ionized in deep space since 1965. So it's very tempting to connect the first generation of stars and galaxies with this reionization, this transition. So we call the period when the first galaxies form cosmic dawn, and this period of ionization from neutral hydrogen to an ionized hydrogen reionization. And so, you know, this is the frontier. We know very little observationally about this time. Paradoxically, we know more about the microwave background than we do about this period. And here's a simulation of this reionization process. What you see is the dark hydrogen clouds, and then the ionized bubbles are shown in blue. And the expansion of the universe is being removed in this simulation. So what you see is a cube of space, and you can see eventually these ionized bubbles connect, rather like Swiss cheese, and then eventually the universe is completely ionized. So rather slow movie, but this is 200 million years, so sped it up a little bit for your benefit. And this is produced by a group at Stanford. So the questions are really very simple. I mean, one of the delights of working in an area where there's not much information is that the questions we pose are really quite simple. So question number one, when did this happen? And I'll bring you up to date on some very recent developments which suggest this happened much more recently than we earlier imagined. And then secondly, you know, is that picture that I showed you correct? Was the reionization initiated by stars and galaxies in the early universe? How would we answer that question? Well, we'd have to count the number of galaxies, and we'd have to understand their spectrum, how many ionizing photons a typical galaxy produces. So the work I'm going to describe to you is mostly review-like, but it features work that I've done both with Hubble and with ground-based telescopes, such as the Keck telescope. The Hubble work was a big program that I led about 2 years ago, involving these players in the United States and a group at Edinburgh. And the more recent work that I'm doing on spectroscopy is with my former students, and also with the group that I'm building up at University College London. So I like this slide. This shows the progress in the most distant object spectroscopically confirmed over my career. So you've got year along the bottom and the redshift and the y-axis. So, you know, when I was an undergraduate, the most distant objects were quasars. They were discovered in 1960. But galaxies, the most distant galaxy was only a redshift of 0.5 or so. And then when large telescopes began in earnest, you can see that the redshift record for galaxies increased. And then when the Keck telescope became available in the 1990s and the VLT, you can see that quasars and galaxies began to compete. And then along came gamma ray bursts, and these are of course spectacular objects, but they're very brief in their luminous period. But gamma ray bursts were found out to redshifts of 8 or so. So today the most distant quasar is at just beyond the redshift of 7. The most distant galaxy I think is at a redshift of 8.68. And I'll show you that this is what we think is the reionization era. So we are now beginning to penetrate objects during this interesting transition. So how would we determine when reionization happens? What we would like to do is see the transition in the neutral gas. We would like to measure the amount of neutral gas in the intergalactic medium. And one way to do this would be to use the quasars and to get the spectrum of the quasar and look at the absorption along the line of sight. So here's a quasar. It's basically being used as a beacon. And the light from the quasar passes to Earth and you see hydrogen absorption, particularly this very prominent absorption, Lyman alpha, in absorption due to cold clouds of hydrogen. This is sometimes called the Gram-Peterson effect. And there's two ways you can do this. One is you can measure the amount of opacity in hydrogen as a function of redshift. The London alpha line is, of course, seen at many different redshifts along the line of sight to the quasar. You can also look at the effect of the quasar on its vicinity. And this is sometimes called the near zone test. So here's two optical examples. One is a gamma ray burst at a redshift of 6.3. You can see its spectrum here. And you can look at the most distant quasar. This is at a redshift of 7. And these two techniques, the near zone technique and the opacity, allow you to measure the neutrality of the gas. So here's results from many quasars and these two gamma ray bursts. And this is now the opacity. So this is the opacity of neutral hydrogen. And you can see it's increasing. And there's some evidence that it's increasing more rapidly at a redshift of about 5.5 or so. Now, this was the first indication in about 10 years ago that something was changing at a redshift of about 6 or so. But there's been very little progress in this application since then for two reasons. One, there are very few gamma ray bursts and quasars at high redshift. The pace of discovery of these distant quasars has slowed down. And secondly, if you look on the y-axis over here, I've converted the opacity into the mass fraction of neutral gas per unit volume. And you can see the numbers are very, very small, 10 to the minus 3, 10 to the minus 2. So only a very small amount of hydrogen per unit volume completely saturates and removes the light of the quasar or the galaxy shortwood of its redshift. And so it's not a very sensitive test of reionization. It tells you when it starts to happen, but it's not a very accurate measurement of the progress at earlier times. And we can't find many objects earlier than that. So a much more interesting probe is the microwave background itself, which is polarized. And the polarization is caused by the scattering of the microwave radiation by the electrons in the intergalactic medium. So we're sitting on the Earth, or just around the Earth, and we look out to the microwave background, and there's a column of electrons all the way from us to when reionization began to happen. And we can measure the optical depth of this scattering, and it's usually converted into the redshift at which reionization reached its maximum transition, sometimes called the redshift of instantaneous reionization. We don't imagine that reionization was instantaneous, but it's a label for telling us when it happened. So the WMAP satellite, which is now finished, took 9 years of data, and you can see the optical depth here progressively settling down as they got more and more data. And so you can see it's a small number, 0.09, 0.087, 0.08, and so forth. And they reckoned that this was consistent with reionization peaking at a redshift of 10.5. So the picture until recently was that reionization began at a redshift of 20, and as the quasars tell us, it ended at a reionization of 6, a redshift of 6 or so. And, you know, the stability of the WMAP result over many years convinced us that this was a very robust picture. But, you know, so often in astronomy, along comes another experiment and they get a different result. And that's exactly what happened with the Planck satellite. And the Planck satellite, which has also completed its data taking, the Planck consortium argued that the WMAP result was much more challenging to measure. And they derived a measurement independently of the technique that the Planck, that the WMAP team used. And you can see the optical depth has come down to 0.067. compared to 0.088. And if you convert that to the peak of the redshift where the peak of transition occurs, it comes down from 10.5 to 8.9. And you may think, well, that's not a very big change, but I'll show you that that has a very important effect where the galaxies are responsible for reionization. So I showed you this picture at the beginning of the lecture. There's two ways in which we can probe the abundance of galaxies at early times. One is we can point Hubble, you know, hope to get a large amount of observing time and sit in one place for a long, long time. And that work was done in our campaign in 2012, which was called the Hubble Ultra Deep Field. This goes for the observational astronomers, this goes to a depth of 30th magnitude, and it gave us the first glimpse of galaxies in this redshift range that I showed you before. But it also revealed a large number of galaxies beyond the most distant quasars. And since then, there have been further deep imaging. There's a survey called the Candle Survey, which is a wider area survey, not quite as deep, but bigger area. And the second technique is gravitational lensing. So gravitational lensing involves pointing the Hubble through in the direction of a rich cluster of galaxies, such as this one here, which acts as a focusing, a magnifying system that brings into view distant galaxies that are intrinsically faint but are boosted in their brightness by the focusing properties of the foreground cluster. So this cluster is much closer by. Here's another one here. And in many cases, these background galaxies have a multiply image so that you can see three images of the same source, which gives you valuable information on their distance. So the good news is that these two very different techniques, pointing in the blank areas of sky, using clusters of galaxies as magnifying glasses, give similar results to the abundance of galaxies as a function of redshift. So what you see here is the volume density of star formation. So this is the plotted against redshift. So you can see here's today. And as we go back to a redshift of 2 or so, it peaks. And then there's this significant decline over 2 orders of magnitude. And it's certainly true that the error bars at the highest redshift are still quite large. But the two methods do broadly agree. Now, I told you this difference in redshift, 8.9 compared to 10.5. And that makes a very big difference in whether galaxies are responsible for reionization, because you can see the abundance is falling very steeply. So if you move reionization from a peaking at a redshift of here to peaking at a redshift of here, say, it makes quite a big difference. So if we take this this distribution of galaxies and their luminosity distribution, then you can, if you assume they have a certain ionizing output, which I'll come to later, then you can do the experiment and say, what would the optical depth of electron scattering be as you go out in redshift? And what you can see is it increases. And as you get to redshifts of 5, it starts to flatten off, simply because the abundance of galaxies is falling so steeply. But you can see it would be impossible to reproduce the WMAP optical depth. But this just squeaks in and matches the Planck result. Now these two results are only 2.5 sigma or so apart. So this is telling us that we can just about match reionization. Now very recently, the Planck people have refined their measurement. And the rumor is, this paper is not yet out, but we all know the result, as so many people are talking about it, that the Planck result has come down. So it's an even closer match to this prediction. So if this is correct, and there are many questionable assumptions, which I'm going to come to, about the population of galaxies, then reionization is much more recent. It began at a redshift of 12. This is the neutral fraction, so you can see it's almost completely neutral at a redshift of 12, and is pretty well completely ionized by a redshift of 6. And you know, that's an era where we're probing galaxies already. So we are already studying objects within this reionization era. So there's one other test, and that is looking at the galaxies themselves. Now, a galaxy that's forming stars has hydrogen gas. The stars are hot. They heat the hydrogen gas. That hydrogen gas glows in Lyman alpha in emission. So we heard about Lyman alpha in absorption across along the line of sight to quasar. We're now talking about Lyman alpha emission in the individual galaxies. And up to 7% of the light of a young galaxy could be in this Lyman alpha emission line. So for an observer like myself, that's very important, because an emission line has a much better contrast with the night sky than the continuum. So it's a practical way to measure the redshift of a young galaxy. But Lyman alpha, n equals 2 to n equals 1, is a resonant transition. And that means that if there's any residual amount of neutral hydrogen there, that Lyman alpha photon has a very hard time getting very far. So there's this nice little cartoon here by Mark Dykstra. So you remember those ionized bubbles. If the galaxy is sitting in the neutral region, then the Lyman alpha photon is produced, but it doesn't get very far. It's scattered by the hydrogen. If the Lyman alpha photon is in an ionized bubble, it can travel freely through the ionized region, and when it gets to the edge of the bubble, it's Doppler shifted out of resonance by the expansion of the universe. So we would expect a sudden drop in the visibility of this line in individual galaxies as we go into the neutral era. This was an idea that was first proposed by Jordi Morales-Escudé when he was at Cambridge, and Mike Santos, who was one of my students at Caltech. And so we started looking for this effect. So these were two of my students. Dan Stark is now a professor in Arizona. Matt Schenker decided to go to Wall Street and make a large amount of money, but we will keep in touch with him so that, you know, he can help us with future telescopes when he gets very wealthy. And you can see here that we did this big survey with a Keck telescope of 600 spectra or so. And this has been mirrored now by equivalent surveys with the VLT, the VMOS ultra deep survey, more or less giving similar results. So what you see here now is spectra. So these are the one-dimensional spectra. So here's a prominent Lyman alpha line. You can see it's very, very intense. This is a 26th magnitude galaxy with a redshift of 5.5. Here's a weaker Lyman alpha line. And here, this is a two-dimensional representation of the spectrum. So the black is the Lyman alpha emission line, and the redshift is shown in black. And these are night sky residuals. So these are the OH lines in the Earth's atmosphere that, of course, are quite troublesome at these high redshifts. And sure enough, what we find is that if you just look at the fraction of galaxies with Lyman alpha, there's a modest rise to a redshift of 6 or so. So at a redshift of 6, which is when we think reionization ended, 50% or more of the galaxies show this line. But as you go to higher redshift, the number declines very, very sharply. So at a redshift 8, almost none of the galaxies have Lyman alpha. And then this result has been confirmed independently, both on the VLT and by other groups using the Keck telescopes. So it's unfortunately hard to convert this decline into a neutral fraction. It's a complicated calculation, it involves radiative transfer and many imponderables, but broadly speaking, this decline converts to a 30 to 50% change in the neutral fraction in only 200 million years. This was thought to be very hard if reionization was slow, which was the case for WMAP, but it's much less of a problem if the Planck results are correct. If the Planck results are correct, reionization is very fast, and that's what seems to be shown in these observations. But there are many imponderables, I won't go through them. There's cosmic variance, we expect reionization to be patchy, so obviously we will have to continue to make measurements to see if this result holds up. It's pretty obvious looking at this that the error bars are still quite large. And there are other effects as well, like the velocity offset, whether there are outflows that change with time, and so forth. Just to look to the future on this particular topic, the Subaru telescope is unique in having a very big field of view compared to the VLT and Keck. And it has a monster camera called Hypersupine Cam, which is in operation. And we're building an equivalent spectrograph that will survey over this 1.5 degree field of view. So this camera is looking at Lyman alpha using narrowband filters. So you make a narrowband filter and you place that over the CCD in the focal plane, and you get the distribution of Lyman alpha lines. And so if you can do this at different redshifts with different filters, then of course, back to this, you trace the shapes of these bubbles. It's a very clever idea. So you can actually see the bubbles, how big they are, and in principle, how old they are, in order to reproduce the distribution that you see. So this this camera is now operating. It's going to do 25 square degrees. And so that's going to be very interesting in the next two or three years or so. So I'm going to, having convinced you now that reionization is quick, I'm now going to tell you a twist in the story that happened only last year. So most of the galaxies that we've studied beyond a redshift of 7 to look for this signal were found using what we call the Lyman break technique. So the idea is that you look for the signature in the spectrum of the galaxy. So these are the Hubble data, you can see these are photometric points, and then suddenly you can see there's a drop in signal. And this is the telltale sign of the Lyman alpha absorption, and gives you the what we call the photometric redshift of the galaxy. But an undergraduate, who's now a postgraduate at UCL, Guido Roberts-Bossani and his collaborators, used Spitzer data to add an additional point, and you can see the objects here where there's an excess in one of the Spitzer bands, specifically the 4.5 micron bands. And in this redshift range 7 to 9, this would be because a very prominent nebula line of oxygen pollutes the broadband photometry. So you can see the fit is pretty good, and then you get to the Spitzer band here, and suddenly there's an excess. And this would be the telltale signature that there's an intense emission line in that particular wavelength. We don't have the capability to get a spectrum at that wavelength at the moment, because it's an area that's where the Earth's atmosphere is very bright. Well, they looked at they found four such luminous objects, and they're shown here. And they're very bright, so we were able to follow them up with Keck. So this was done last year, and it's a very interesting story. The first one was observed by Pascal Auch, who's now he's in the US at the moment, he's moving to Lausanne. And its photometric redshift was 7.9, and here's Lyman alpha in emission. at a redshift of 7.73, and it was the redshift record. And then a month later, or 2 months later, Adi Zitrin and I observed another one, this one here. This has a photometric redshift of 8.57, spectroscopic redshift of 8.68. And we've observed the other two, and all of them show Lyman alpha. So there is a potential higher redshift record. We can talk about that if there's time. That's not a ground-based spectrum. It's a Hubble spectrum, and you can see it's pretty noisy, but it's claimed to be a redshift of 11 or so. But back to these four galaxies, four out of four sources with this excess line show Lyman alpha. So you're now probably very confused. I told you Lyman alpha is immediately extinguished when we're in the neutral era. So the hypothesis is that these are unusual sources. They could have active galactic nuclei, for example, that produce very strong ionizing radiation. So they've created their own early ionized bubbles. And so what we've been doing is trying to follow up these objects to see whether this is the case. We imagine that there are black holes at early times, and it may well be that these objects, which are, after all, extremely bright, so where are we? They're much brighter than the other objects we've been talking about. They may be early developers. So let me turn finally to this question of whether galaxies reionize the universe. I told you we need the abundance. It's really Saha's equation. So we need the ionizing output, so that's the number of ionizing photons per second. It depends on the abundance of galaxies, not just the number, but the distribution with luminosity, because there's a range of luminosities. There are luminous ones and feeble ones. We need this quantity psi ion, which tells us, for a given star formation rate, what fraction of the photons have the energy to ionize hydrogen. So there's a Lyman limit and shorter wavelength photons. And then the most annoying thing that we need to measure is we need to measure the fraction of those photons that can escape the galaxy, get past all the neutral gas that might be in the galaxy, and get into the intergalactic medium. And, well, of course, even with this huge, long exposures with Hubble, we don't see every galaxy. I mean, it's pretty obvious. There's a flux limit. So here's a luminosity function. So this is the number of galaxies per unit volume against its luminosity. Here are the rare luminous objects, and of course that's what goes to feeble objects. There are many more of them. And even in this ultra-deep field, we have a limit. And so the question is, what happens below this limit? We obviously have to extrapolate to some fainter limit to explain whether galaxies are capable of reionizing the universe. So one way to make progress on this is through this gravitational lensing. So the gravitational lensing boosts the objects that are intrinsically faint and brings them into view. So this is the real luminosity function. This is at redshift 7. Here's the data that we took from the ultra-deep field. So there are various measures of it here. Schenker et al. Here's this one here. This was the limit, minus 17. And then using the gravitational lensing, three clusters, we can make some progress. We can go quite a bit fainter, actually, extending. And the most important thing to measure is the slope, of course, because that tells you... So we estimate that when Hubble has completed this cluster program, which is called the Frontier Fields, it will survey six clusters in total. We estimate that the integrated luminosity will be known to 30%. So that's this quantity, rho uv. So we're fairly sure, I mean, 30% is pretty good in this business. But the more interesting question is, you know, the stellar populations of these galaxies. What kind of ionizing photons do they produce? So the way in which this has been done until now is the colour of the galaxies. And it's very simple. A young metal poor galaxy will be very, very blue, will have very steep ultraviolet continuum, and it will have a large ionizing output. Whereas a metal-rich galaxy will be somewhat redder and will have a lower ionizing output. And over the last 5 years or so, the observers have all agreed that we can measure this ultraviolet slope, and that's been used to tell us that the galaxies have a certain ionizing capability. This is the ionizing flux per unit star formation rate. But this figure here shows that that it's very, very ambiguous to determine the ionizing spectrum of a galaxy from its colors. There's so many imponderables. There's dust, there's metallicity, there's the stellar initial mass function. All of these are variables that we might be able to understand locally, but we just don't have the details at high redshift to answer these questions. And it can make a big difference. A much more reliable way of measuring the ionizing spectrum is to look at metal lines. And these metal lines are quite prominent in the ultraviolet. I've told you about Lyman alpha, the lines of ionized carbon and oxygen. And the advantage of these lines is, firstly, they're in the ultraviolet, so they're redshifted into the optical and near-infrared at high redshift, where we have spectrographs. And secondly, they have very high ionization potentials. So they're sensitive to whether the ionizing radiation is hard, such as would be the case if it was non-thermal from a quasar or a black hole, or if it's soft, as would be the case from a stellar population. So this is where we bring in Stefan Charlot in Paris and his group, Anna Feltre. What they've done is predict the ratios of these lines, these ultraviolet lines, as a function of whether it's non-thermal, whether it's a metal-rich population or a metal-poor population. And, you know, the name of the game now is to try to go to these high-redshift galaxies and see these lines. And they're faint, they're even fainter than Lyman alpha. And so here's a lensed galaxy at a redshift of 7.05. This is a doublet of carbon-4. So one advantage of these lines is that they're doublets. So carbon-4 is a doublet, carbon-3 is a doublet also. So I don't know if you can believe this doublet here at redshift 7.05. Here's another doublet in emission at 7.73 in that distant object. So I just got back from Keck. I arrived last night in Munich. We have 3 nights with Keck, and we've now surveyed all of those luminous objects. And the good news is we're seeing these carbon lines in several of them, including the object at 8.68. I can't tell you yet whether it's consistent with them being non-thermal, but certainly the data is there for us to address this. So there is an alternative route to this mysterious quantity psi ion, and that's looking at the Balmer lines, which are recombination lines. And this was an idea that was pioneered by Richard Bewins, and he took galaxies between redshift 3.8 and 5, and he estimated the strength of the Balmer line from the Spitzer photometry. We can't see H alpha beyond a redshift of 2.5 from the ground. So we have to infer it from Spitzer, and we calculated the psi ion here, and there's the distribution. So I just put on the value of psi ion that we get from these more distant objects, and you can see they lie on the tail. So as we go to early times, the ionizing radiation is definitely harder than it is at lower redshift. So the last imponderable is this escape fraction. So I told you not all of the ionizing radiation can get out of the galaxy. So how are we going to measure this? And it's very, very difficult. Ideally, we would see the leaking radiation below the Lyman limit. So here's a stacked spectrum of several galaxies at redshift 2. And don't know if you can see, this is the line and limit, and you can see some of them have no flux, and others, it's clear that there's radiation leaking. Unfortunately, this is the most sensitive way of measuring it, but it's impractical for high redshift galaxies because all of these Lyman alpha forest clouds that I showed you in the quasar spectrum get in the way and extinguish any signal that we would expect to see. And indeed, the more that people have looked at this, the more worried they've become that there aren't enough escaping ionizing photons. So, for example, a very nice technique is to use Hubble, to use a ground-based imager with a narrow filter below the Lyman alpha line. So here are some galaxies at redshifts 2 to 3, and then you take an image with a narrow filter to see the leaking radiation. But when you go back with Hubble, you can see that much of the flux that you see below the Lyman limit is coming from galaxies in the foreground along the line of sight. And so it's a big problem. Now, we think that there is a population of galaxies which have leaking radiation, and these are the so-called Lyman alpha emitters. And they're shown here. They have very intense oxygen 3, just like those objects that Peter Robert Spicerni selected. And when you look at the psi ion from their oxygen emission, you can see that the spectrum is harder. And also, they're Lyman continuum leakers. They have a high fraction of radiation leaking. So these look like they are the low redshift analogs of the objects that are creating these ionized bubbles at early times. And this idea that the intense oxygen 3 emitters are the objects that ionize the universe at early times has been vindicated by two independent tests. One is by Isotov et al. He used a COS spectrograph on Hubble to look at Lyman leaking at a low redshift. And Eros van Zeller and his collaborators found a clear evidence of leaking radiation in a very intense oxygen 3 emitting galaxy at redshift 3 or so. So this is probably the biggest uncertainty now, the fraction of photons that can escape. And if I end with the future, so we have James Webb Space Telescope, so due for launch in 2018, so very, very close now. Conferences on planning for James Webb, there's two this year, one in Edinburgh, one in Spain. And the deadline for proposals, the first proposals, is only about a year or so away. So James Webb is now a very real mission. Hopefully it will work. The Large Ground-Based Telescopes in 2024, the ELT, and in the far future, a 30-meter telescope as well, and in the far future, the Square Kilometer Array. Now, I haven't talked about mapping the hydrogen directly, but one of the neatest ways of studying reionization would be to chart, using the 21-centimeter line, the distribution of cold neutral gas. So let me just talk briefly about those missions. James Webb is in space, of course, but its main advantage is that we will see these lines spectroscopically for the first time. So all of these lines that have to be inferred from spectrophotometry will be directly visible from spectrographs on James Webb. So you can see oxygen 2, oxygen 3 will be directly visible. So this is very exciting. It gives us the composition of the gas, tells us the ionizing spectrum. Ground-based facilities like the ELT will have adaptive optics, and paradoxically will have better image quality than James Webb. So this is the reverse of the situation today. We're used to thinking Hubble takes high-quality, high-resolution images, and spectroscopy is the province of the ground-based telescopes. But for this particular application, the ground-based telescopes will not be able to do the necessary spectroscopy, but the imaging will be done better from the ground. And that's because these objects are really very, very small. So you can see they're unresolved with James Webb, but the ELT with adaptive optics will actually resolve them. So there's some many big questions. The other is the role of ALMA. I haven't had time to talk about ALMA. Is there dust at high redshift? Well, there's one very puzzling observation. A galaxy at a redshift of 7.5, here's the VLT spectrum, and it's detected by ALMA. Even though it's relatively blue, the inference is it has a large amount of dust. So it's very, very important to understand whether dust is confusing or extinguishing some of the star formation that we infer from Hubble. And then I should end with the Italian viewpoint, the role of AGN. Okay, so this is Piero Nadal. So the idea here is that we're slowly beginning to learn about the UV luminosity function of active galactic nuclei. It's been very difficult to do this at high redshift. It's claimed that the UV luminosity function extends to low luminosities, and if you assume all of the radiation, non-thermal radiation, escapes, then it's certainly true that AGN could produce a significant number of the ionizing photons. The problem I have with this idea is that when you get to faint AGN, it's unrealistic to assume that all of the ultraviolet light is non-thermal. The AGN, you know, are sitting in star-forming galaxies, and so I think it exaggerates the contribution to assume that 100% of that light escapes. So let me end with the challenges. Number one, this development of Planck. It's very, very important. Planck has moved reionization to a later time. It's suddenly a fast transition. That's very important news for the LOFAR and the square kilometer array. But is it correct? So Planck, the team is still working on polarization data, the method of the WMAP team. If they confirm that low tau, that's very good news for the idea that galaxies are primarily responsible. Next, we will see the Subaru data. That's going to be very important in changing the way we look at the Lyman alpha emitters. Can we see the pattern of ionizing bubbles evolving? Can we correlate that with 21 centimeter results, for example, from LOFAR? This is the biggest challenge, the escape fraction of ionizing photons. We need it to be about 10%. We can't measure it directly, even with James Webb. It will not be possible to measure the escaping fraction from James Webb. So we need to understand nebulae. And you know, I've shown you that these oxygen-free emitters seem to hold the key, because the ratio of oxygen-3 to oxygen-2 is unusually strong. The production rate of ionizing photons, that's going to be really well dealt with by James Webb, because we have these high ionization lines, we can see them very accurately. And you know, I'm optimistic that AGN will have a role, but I don't think it's going to be the dominant one. And then finally, we need more observations from ALMA to understand whether dust is a complication in the story. But to conclude, I hope I've convinced you, I couldn't have given this talk even, you know, 3 years ago. But the progress is very, very rapid. I mean, James Webb coming up, I think the progress is going to accelerate, and it's going to be very interesting to see what happens. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much for this very interesting talk about the very recent results on the early universe. It's a tradition that the first questions can come from students, PhD students, master students. Are there any student questions?
Come on.
If not, I open the session for everyone. Questions.
Yeah. Are there any good theoretical simulations to try to nail what F escape would be, at least from standard cosmology?
Yes, so the question is, you know, what would the simulators say about the escape fraction? And they predict that it should be higher in the early galaxies. And the argument goes as follows, that the early galaxies are small, star formation during these formative years is intense, and radiation pressure blasts a hole in the neutral gas around the star-forming region, and that you create cones of ionizing radiation. And so the galaxy, the small galaxies are more porous. They have holes in the neutral gas. So, you know, we would expect the ionizing radiation to get out more easily in such systems. I would say that not, you know, as is often the case with theorists, you know, not all theorists agree. So some believe that this argument is of short duration in time, whereas we need it, you know, to be sustained over several hundred million years. We need this figure to be more than 10% on average for every galaxy across the whole range of luminosities. So it's, you know, so it's quite a challenge. I should say, it's, you know, there are other possibilities for the source of these ionizing photons, but they're fairly esoteric, like decaying particles. And, you know, the question then is, why would these particles decay at just particularly this time in cosmic history? The association with early objects like galaxies and quasars is appealing, I think, but it's done by celestial objects rather than some new physics.
Other questions? When you showed the development of tau from WMF1357 to planet, it looked like not just the error bars got smaller, but it changed monotonically in one direction to lower redshifts. Is there any understanding
about
this systematic?
Everything is coming down. Yeah, and I'm not a CMB person, but the first early results from WMAP suffered largely from foreground subtraction issues. The Planck result, how far back we need to go, claims that, that the method they used was inaccurate, and I'm referring to a conversation I had with Georgia Stethew, who's a Planck expert. It's probably too far back. Here we go. So how did they... What they did was they correlated the temperature with the polarization E mode. Now, not to be confused with the controversial B mode. Okay, this is the E mode, the E vector of the polarization. And what you see is a feature. This is multiple, so this is angle, this is a big angle. And what you see is a peak at 10 degrees, okay? And the argument is that the horizon of the universe is 10 degrees at the peak of reionization. And that's how they got this redshift of 10.5 or so. So what the Planck people argued was that this is very uncertain, because the number of multiples where you can see this signal is very limited. You know, you only have one universe, and you only have, you know, you statistically look at this. And so they derived it from a completely independent method. And if you read the Planck paper, they argue that the WMAP tau, the error bar, was underestimated. That's probably as much as I know myself, but... So now the Planck people are going to apply this technique to their own data. They've had a lot of trouble with polarization data, but they now apparently have solved that problem. And so it'll be very interesting to see whether they get, you know, whether they get another. This is not from the polarization data yet. So it will be very interesting to see whether this comes down any further. But you're right, it's quite amusing that it's just a monotonic decline as we've learned more and more about micro.
I'm wondering about your exciting solar hardness of the spectrum. What would you infer about the stellar IMF that is behind it? Can you really say it's complicated from just looking at these numbers?
No, so it's a very good question. So the question is, if we have have these line ratios, so we have carbon-4, carbon-3, helium, we haven't seen helium yet, oxygen-3, the lines that we've seen so far, carbon-4, carbon-3, oxygen-3, the ratios tell you the contribution of a non-thermal radiation field, assuming it's a power law, the metallicity of the stars, but for a given stellar initial mass function. So the alternative, of course, is you can tweak the initial mass function, make it top heavy, you know, and that would change these curves. So the only way in which ultimately you could disentangle this, well, certainly you can measure the metallicity if you have both carbon lines, you know, that gives you a handle on that, then that's very, very valuable. But the more of these lines you get, the easier it will be to break the degeneracy. At the moment, we're spending 5 hours on Keck per object to see, you know, one of these lines. And it's annoying, the lines are not all in the same band. So the VLT has an instrument called X-Huber, which I'm sure many of you know, that covers all of these lines at once. So we have time on X-Huber. We're in the queue, you know, and we're waiting like everybody else for our data. So hopefully that will come in due course. But you're right, we can't, it's not easy to break the degeneracy between the initial mass function and some of these other variables.
So I read some recent work on the simulation side about escape fractions, and this says that the escape fraction gets significantly higher when you consider binaries. So I wonder if this is implemented in your spectra.
So we're not, you know, our approach to the escape fraction is entirely empirical. So we are, you know, simply dumb observers. You know, basically what we did in our paper here is we assumed 20% for all the galaxies, and all we're showing here is that if we have a psi ion that was consistent with the color, and this is a paper by Robertson et al, but you can look at the other group, Richard Billman, it's very similar. So we have no preconceived idea of what the escape fraction is. So what we're doing in this analysis is assuming a certain ionizing spectrum consistent with galaxies, metal core galaxies. We're assuming a constant 20% escape fraction, and we're demonstrating that galaxies could reionize the universe and explain the Planck tau. So if the escape fraction came down to, if the escape fraction went up to say 50%, you know, probably, you know, we'd overgenerate. So we'd have to adjust either the ionizing spectrum, or maybe the luminosity function doesn't go quite as faint as we assume. So there's, you know, we're juggling three numbers here to show that it's a self-consistent picture, but we can't at the moment verify any of those numbers accurately. So of course that's where the interaction with theorists is so important.
Yeah, in the first simulation you showed, you said that the expansion of the universe is not taken into account.
That was the movie. Yeah.
Okay. But is it generally taken into account or not?
So the movie, was a simulation of reionization from Tom Abell and his group at Stanford. And, you know, of course the simulation takes into account the expansion of the universe. But in order that it could be fit on the screen and didn't, you know, completely go off scale, he took out the expansion purely for the visualization.
Are there any more questions? One question about the adoptive metallicity of this galaxy that this redshift. How strong is that?
Well, we don't know. We can't measure the metallicity. I showed you the color, so let's start with the color. So we measure the color. Here it is. It's beta of -2, so that's, if you fit this UV continuum, so from about Lyman alpha down to about 1500 angstroms, you measure the beta, it's -2, And then you could say, well, it's consistent with a dust-free, metal-rich population. Okay, but it could be metal-poor. If it's metal-poor, it'd be down here. But it could have dust. So, you know, it's very difficult to disentangle the composition of the gas in these objects. So James Webb, of course, will measure the traditional line ratios, oxygen, you know, oxygen 2, oxygen 3, H-beta, and so forth. So that'll be very important. There are many other things on here, the extinction, the metallicity, and you can see all these curves. The main point is that the color is a very poor guide to this ionizing radiation. So I suggested that a more reliable way is to look at the excitation, these high ionization lines, and look at their ratios to get the spectrum. That, in principle, can tell you something about the metallicity. But when we have the metallicity as well, then we can break the degeneracy. We'll have both the gas phase metallicity and the nature of the ionizing field. At the moment, we just don't have enough data to break those degeneracies.
Are there more questions? If that is not the case, I will thank Richard again for this talk and everyone for the interesting discussion. If you have any further questions, you can join us to come with us to the Dorfschenkel in the Lutherstraße to have further questions, and Richard will certainly answer them. So have a good evening. Bye.